Welcome into another edition of Tide and Tiger. Scott Griffin here. Rodney Orr, our expert from TiderInsider.com. Spring football. Rodney, you got pollen all over the house, all over the deck furniture. Spring football's on us, is it not?
Yeah, actually it is, Scott, and you caught me on my way to Lowe's. I'm going to get a power washer.
Are you?
So I can get all that pollen off of my vehicle and off of my house and all of those things. And I need to get some wasp killer while I'm out because those things are everywhere.
Wow.
So, and the birds nesting up under my overhang in the back. So I got a lot going on.
I don't know if we need to go into your whole litany list of what you had to do around the house, but it's very interesting. No, in all seriousness, it is. And it means spring, obviously. Seems like we're getting a little later start here. And we're going to go over the defense. Obviously, if you missed the offensive portion, it's on podbean.com. It's at tiderinsider.com. You can find it. We did that last week. We're doing the defense now right before spring practice starts. And obviously, we'll carry these on as we go. Brought to you by Hong Kong Tailors in Birmingham. But Ramesh Kirpalani will come see you anywhere you are. If you're in Tuscaloosa or Huntsville or Mobile or wherever around the state or anywhere he can drive, he will personally come talk to you, see your style, see your fit and fashion, pick out the fabrics you want for you, and make you incredible. Casual clothing, work clothing, sports coats, pants, whatever. Check him out. Hong Kong Tailors. It's KirpalaniTailors.com is the website. I'll tell you more about them in a moment. All right, Rodney, let's start with the coaching staff. That's where the bulk of the change is. There's a lot of changes everywhere. Only one guy is back on the defensive side of the ball, and even he will be doing new things. So were they all these guys gone, defensive backs and Rashaan Evans and now a new coach staff? This is really a critical is probably not the right word, but a very interesting, important year for Alabama defensively.
No question. I think you're right. Exactly. I mean, when you look at this Alabama defense, I mean, I think, you know, uncertainty may be the word because there's so much newness with this defense. I mean, you mentioned the guys that they lost. They lost six defensive backs, Scott. They lost two outstanding linebackers in the middle. You mentioned Rashaan Evans and also Sean Dion Hamilton, who missed a good part of the end of the year with that knee injury again. And then on the defensive line, you lost Da'Ron Payne, who's going to be a first-round draft pick and a guy that's just irreplaceable, actually. So, you know, you've got a lot of new faces, not only as players, but also as coaches. And you mentioned Tosh Lupoi. This will be his first time to call a defense as a defensive coordinator. All the other positions are new. Craig Kuligowski on the defensive line, an outstanding developer of talent, no question about that. Pete Golding, an inside linebackers coach. Now, he has called defenses, did a tremendous job at UT San Antonio in the years that he was there. He took them from 101 nationally defensively when he took over to number five, well, one of the top five defenses in the country last year. So he's young, only 34 years old, but does an outstanding job. And so I'm sure that he'll lend quite a hand to Tosh Lupoi in terms of calling the defense. And I hear they have a great relationship, by the way. And then in the secondary, Carl Scott is a guy that was a safeties coach last year at Texas Tech and had been hired with Billy Napier as the head coach at Louisiana Lafayette to become their defensive coordinator. That lasted maybe a week before Nick Saban offered him this job. So a lot of turnover on the defensive staff, on the defensive side of the ball, a lot of changes. So you're right, Scott. There are a lot of question marks about this defense heading into spring practice.
No doubt. But we do know this, that Nick Saban rarely makes bad coaching moves when he replaces somebody. And Alabama is rarely caught without talent. All right, let's start with the defensive line. Certainly Da'Ron Payne is a guy that brought a lot of pain to opponents for 3 years at Alabama. That's where everybody's focus goes. But there is talent coming back. Raekwon Davis showed flashes of greatness, to be honest with you. Isaiah Bugs as well. What do you see on the defensive line?
Yeah, you know, Raekwon really came along late in the season, especially took that next step, I think, Scott, in the playoffs. So you hope that's a carryover into spring and then as you lead into his junior year. And you know, at 6'6", 310 pounds, whatever he is, he is an incredible athlete. We saw that with that interception against Georgia and the way he ran after the catch. I mean, he's just a tremendous athlete. He's a guy, Scott, that could position himself is to start to look forward to being a first-round draft pick next year. So he's really that good. Isaiah Bugs, listen, Isaiah Bugs was the number one junior college defensive lineman in the country last year when he came in at Alabama. He started to bud some during the season. I think it took him a while to learn what it takes to be successful on this level. I think this is an opportunity now for Isaiah Bugs to take that next step. I think when you look at Bugs and you look at Raekwon Davis, they give Alabama two incredibly gifted defensive linemen that I think have a chance to be just outstanding players. You can't replace Da'Ron Payne in the middle. There's no question about that. But you have to build around what you have. And that's one of the great things about Nick Saban that we've seen in the past, is that he takes the players that he has and builds to the strengths of those guys. And I think, you know, people say, well, how are we going to replace Da'Ron Payne? You don't necessarily have to replace him with a guy, and you can't replace him with a guy of that talent. You just build around the strengths that you have. And Bugs and Raekwon Davis are a great start to build around. I really like Quinnen Williams from Winona. Every time he was in the game last year as a redshirt freshman, he made plays. He's just a playmaker as an edge guy in terms of a defensive end. I think he's outstanding. LeBrian Ray was a true freshman, broke his foot later in the season. But, you know, once he started playing against Texas A&M, he was really showing a ton of promise. I think he's going to be an outstanding player. And I tell you, the guy to keep an eye on is an interior defensive lineman. We've mentioned him before. Redshirt freshman Fedarian Mathis out of Monroe, Louisiana.
Yeah.
6'4", 310. He's a guy to really keep an eye on. He did an outstanding job, had a great fall as a redshirt last year. I think you'll see him bud. And Stephon Wynn is an early enrollee, a guy that's a true freshman. His dad, Stephon Wynn Sr., was an outstanding player in his day at Clemson. So he's got the bloodlines. He's got a lot of things you look for. 6'4", 310. Going through spring practice is going to be a huge, huge benefit for him. And let's not forget, Johnny DeWitt is still around. He's a guy that is a big 6'3", 325-pound guy that hopefully, Scott, he can take on that Darren Lake role. If you remember how Darren Lake could provide 6 or 8 to 10 snaps a game. If Johnny DeWitt can do that in the middle next year, which he looked pretty good when he got some opportunities last year, but if he can do that in the middle, then I think that would be a really big key and a bonus for Alabama. Let me say this before we move forward. Coach Kuligowski is one of the best at developing players.
No doubt.
He took guys at Missouri that were lightly recruited players and developed them into first-round draft picks. Now, again, he can't work supernatural magic, but he is a guy that is very, very gifted at getting the best out of his players. So I would think that with the talent he has here at Alabama, the potential some of these guys have, that you're going to see these players really develop.
All right, let's transition to linebackers, but kind of stay with edge guys a little bit first. You know, we know about Anfernee Jennings and the amazing comeback he had from his injuries to just be a wrecking crew against Clemson. Also, Terrell Lewis, who was fantastic and showed flashes and had a great playoffs as well coming back from injury. Talk about those two, and then an intriguing one that you and I are kind of looking at that could be moved to an edge position and really needs to live up to his billing that a lot of people talk about is Ben Davis out of Gordo. A lot of people have expected a lot out of him, and we frankly haven't seen a lot yet.
Yeah, well, Anfernee Jennings, the big question about him, first of all, what a dominant game he had against Clemson. I mean, he just totally abused those offensive tackles, and it was unfortunate when he went down with that knee injury, Scott, and he had another issue with that I think complicated matters, but it looks like everything's A-OK in terms of his rehab. Now, we don't have anything official from Nick Saban in terms of Anfernee Jennings this spring, how much contact or if any, that he can have. But, you know, at last word, the expectation was that he would be 100% by August camp. So that's big because he is a difference maker up front. And Terrell Lewis, you mentioned him. He missed the whole season. I mean, he returned after being injured against Florida State in the opener. He played in the Auburn game. Obviously, we know how that game turned out, not very well. But he really turned it up a notch in the playoffs, had the big sack against Georgia that forced the field goal, mm-hmm. as you remember, in overtime. So Terrell Lewis is a difference maker. Now, we're talking about another guy, potential first-round draft pick next year this time, even though he'll only be a junior, but he's a guy to keep an eye on. What a difference maker he is. You're talking about a guy close to 6'5", 255-plus pounds that runs like a deer. So, yeah, Alabama rushing the passer should have no problems with those guys. You mentioned Ben Davis. That's a question that is nonstop. It's been going on for over a year now, everywhere you go. What about Ben Davis? Of course, he's a local guy, West Alabama player. His dad was a legend here, the all-time leading tackler in Alabama football history, Wayne Davis. But Ben Davis is a guy that, you know, quite honestly, some guys develop at a slower rate. I mean, it's just a matter of developing them, finding the best position for them. And I think, you know, they've kind of worked through that a little bit, Scott. And I think they believe that they want to get him bigger, help him become an edge pass rusher. So we'll see what happens with him. But, you know, again, he's an excellent athlete that could contribute. Christian Miller's back. He's a guy that, again, like Terrell Lewis, was injured in the opener, came back against Auburn, played well in the playoffs. Jamie Mosley is back at the outside backer spot. He had to fill in last year when those guys were hurt. Now, here's a guy that I think can be a difference maker. It's just a matter of when. Sophomore Chris Allen, who played some early last year as a true freshman, kind of, had to learn what it takes to play on this level. Has to become a more disciplined player in terms of, you know, keeping his assignments straight. But he's a guy that when you talk about potential, he's right there in terms of Terrell Lewis, that type of ability. I think Chris Allen's going to be an outstanding player in time. And also Jerez Parks, who gray-shirted last year. Remember, he was a top 100 player a couple of years ago coming out of high school. Alabama was out of scholarships. He's from Sebastian River, Florida. Turned down a lot of schools to sit out and wait to get his scholarship as a gray shirt this year at Alabama. So he'll be going through spring practice. He's an edge guy at about 6'4", 255. He's very athletic. He could also work some maybe inside. We'll see. I don't know that it will, but their numbers inside are so low that you could see one of these outside guys work some, you know, on the inside. And let's not forget, too, Vandarius Cowan was a true freshman last year. He's got all kinds of ability, could play inside or could play outside, was really coming on, you know, late in the season in the bowl practices. We'll see what he does this spring and kind of how things fall for him. But he's a very talented guy as well.
And the name that we're forgetting about that also could come back is Christian Miller, who, you know, Alabama was very high on heading into the fall last year. And one of those three that got the season-ending injury that never came back very much. You know, I look for big things from him. He's endured a lot. I really want to see him have a good senior year.
Yeah, he's a team player, first of all. A great representative here of this program has been. Came in redshirted as a true freshman, even though he was a five-star player. He came in knowing that he needed time to develop. And, you know, Scott, he signed with Alabama. When he got here, he was a 6'4", 205-pound linebacker. That's not going to cut it. You know that.
No.
That's about safety size, not a lot bigger than Ronnie Harrison. So he's developed now. He's a 250-pound outside backer and still very, very athletic, very smart kid, heady player. I really like Christian Miller, and hopefully he's one of those guys that you say he saved the best for last.
Yeah.
Because potentially he's an excellent player.
All right, inside, we start with a lot of talent. Let's be honest. Mack Wilson, who seems to he's gone to the national junior, I call it a junior day at the NFL Combine. He was one of a handful of guys that went there. I think Terrell Lewis actually went too from Alabama, if I'm not mistaken. And he seems to, when you keep up with him on social media, be really focused for that year that puts him into the National Football League next year. Dylan Moses, as we know, ended the year incredibly strong before he got injured, was actually one of the leaders of the defense for a couple of games there. I know you're high on Markel Benton. Keith Holcomb has been solid and a special teams special player, for lack of various words. kind of go on the inside, guys, what you see. You just had alluded to lack of numbers there. So what are you seeing?
Scott, I think Mac Wilson has a chance to become that next great inside backer that Alabama's had. I think he's already, you know, taking steps in that direction. Had big playoff games. Obviously had an interception return for a touchdown against Clemson. He's a really physical player. He kind of brings that enforcer mindset inside. So I really like Mac Wilson and what he brings this defense. I think he's going to be the bell cow. He's going to be the alpha dog, one of those alpha dogs that Alabama needs for that leadership on the on this defense that's going to be young in a lot of ways. I think Dylan Moses, same way. He played against Mercer quite a bit. Now, he played a lot throughout the season. Had a sack against LSU, but I think he had, 16 tackles in his start against Mercer, had an interception. I think he's a guy that brings that same kind of talent and ability. So when you look at those two guys, I remember when I walked through the gate last year for the first time and saw those two lined up next to each other, I was like, wow. I mean, that's incredible when you see two young players. Mac was a sophomore last year and Dylan a true freshman. And I thought, these are two NFL-looking inside backers physically. So I think they're going to be outstanding together inside. As you mentioned, Keith Holcomb, we expect him right now. We haven't heard that he won't be back. There's been some chatter, I guess, or speculation that maybe he'll stick with baseball because he's an excellent baseball prospect, no question about that, playing for Alabama baseball this spring. So we'll see what happens with Keith Holcomb. Vandarius Cowan, I mentioned him earlier. He's a guy that could play inside and outside. Markell Benton is another guy that came in that talented linebacker core last year with Moses and Chris Allen and Cowan. Markell Benton from Phoenix City Central has a lot of talent, 6'2", 233, playing inside backer right now. It would be huge if he stepped up on the inside, provided Alabama with some solid depth and quality that they need. They really, really need that. Markell Benton has the talent, has the ability. There was a point last year that his name kept popping up as a guy to really watch. So we'll see what he does this spring. And Joshua McMillan's been around a while. He's a veteran player out of Memphis going into, I think, his redshirt junior year. So he's been around a while. And maybe he could provide some depth. We'll see.
Markell Benton, for people that remember his recruiting, I mean, this is a top 10 linebacker prospect consensus, Rodney. Whatever list you want to look on or that you have faith in, he was a top 10 guy. So I agree, about 6'2", 2.5", 235, can move. He might be the wild card to really help this inside, right?
Yeah, a lot of it, so much of it is about maturity, and it's all these guys. I mean, they all have to take the next step. You've seen it with Reuben Foster. We've seen it before that with Rolando McClain when he was here. You don't have a lot of guys that come in on the level, say, of a Dante Hightower or C.J. Mosley in terms of that, just that maturity. I mean, that's really hard to find that complete package straight out of high school. So, Markell Benton is one of those guys. He has the ability. He has the athleticism. He has all the tools. It's just a matter of the maturity, learning what it takes to be successful, and then kind of following the plan. Sticking to the process, as Nick Saban says. And if Markell Benton can do that and make those adjustments, I think he's got a chance to be a great player in time and certainly one that could help this year with depth, quality depth.
Now, the biggest question mark, perhaps on the football team, is the one the head coach is the grad assistant of. That's the secondary. And I jokingly say that because that's how Nick Saban always refers to it. But there's no lack of talent here. But let's split this up two ways, Rodney. Let's first, because we know there's four or five defensive backs coming in that's going to probably vie for playing time, if not get it. But let's start with who's on the practice field right now in spring. Then we'll talk about the newcomers. What do you see? There's talent with Deontay Thompson. He's shown flashes. You've always kind of had an eye for Xavier McKinney. We're waiting on Diggs to show himself. Kyrique McDonald was redshirted, but he's certainly a special talent out of James Clemens and Madison. So what do you see from before we get to the recruits coming in?
Well, let's start that with corners. And Trevon Diggs is a guy that actually won the left corner spot last year heading out of camp and into the opener against FSU. Busted a couple of coverages early in that game, had to be replaced by Levi Wallace, who did a fantastic job, obviously, the entire season playing that left corner spot. Trevon Diggs has got a lot of natural ability. He's got great size. He's 6'2". He's close to 200 pounds. So that's would be a really big corner. He's got all the skills. He's a guy that is very conscientious, Scott. Those are hard to find. He takes this really, really seriously. You know, he didn't have a great A-Day game last year, as you recall. Got burned a couple of times at that left corner spot. I mean, he took it to heart. I mean, he really worked hard. Again, he had some struggles early in the season. They went to Levi Wallace, and Trevon never really gained that spot back, obviously. But Trevon Diggs is a talent. He's a guy that's versatile, has a lot of natural instincts. I thought coming out of high school he was going to be an Eddie Jackson-type safety. He's played safety here, played safety, wide receiver, and returned a kick in the same game as a true freshman. So that shows you about his natural instinctive ability as a football player and his talent. We'll see what happens this spring with him at one of the corner spots. Another guy to keep an eye on, former five-star recruit who signed with LSU out of high school and then went to Mississippi Gulf Coast Community College last year and entered school at Alabama halfway through after the season leading into the playoff games and went through practices for the Clemson and Georgia games. Sabian Smith, again, a former five-star recruit that went to LSU, great talent. He's 6'1". He's close to 200 pounds, so he's a big corner as well. You look at him, he's long, Scott. He's very, very athletic. The buzz around here post those practices, Clemson and Georgia, was that this guy has this skill to develop into potentially another great cornerback here at Alabama. So that's big news because he's gone through practices already.
Yeah.
He's gone through the off-season program. He's developed some, and now he has 15 practices to go through the spring to further develop. So I think that's huge when you're talking about the needs in the secondary. Sabian Smith, Trevon Diggs, Shaheem Carter, going into his junior year now, he's a very versatile player. If you look at the third down against Georgia in overtime, think about this now, the third down play when Terrell Lewis made the sack, the guy who was at the star position was not Tony Brown, the veteran player. It was Shai Carter. And Shai Carter has the ability to play the star spot, could possibly play some corner too. Also is athletic enough and versatile enough to play safety. He's got a lot of versatility. This is a big spring for his development. Jared Maiden's another guy that came in that same recruiting class with Shai Carter. They're juniors now. Jared Maiden has some ability at the corner spot. We'll see what he does. He may even get some work at star spot. Nigel Knott, everybody asks about Nigel Knott. Nigel's a great athlete. He came in that same recruiting class with Carter and Maiden. Got tremendous athletic ability. He was a little bit undersized, but he's put on weight. Injuries has hampered him. We'll see what he does this spring. It's a big spring for him. You mentioned Kareek McDonald. I look at Kareek McDonald. He is a natural football player. Maybe he lacks a little bit in terms of speed. I'm not really sure how he would fit in at corner, but I do know he played the star spot, looked really good. Kind of reminds me of Javier Arenas a little bit with his playmaking ability, though he doesn't have quite the speed that Javier had. But he is a very, very natural football player. So the star spot, maybe even safety for Kareek McDonald. You mentioned Deontay Thompson. Going into his junior year now, was a very highly recruited player out of the Beaumont, Texas area at West Orange Start a couple of 3 years ago. Now he's a redshirt junior. I think he's a budding star. He looked tremendous, I thought, in the playoff games against Clemson and against Georgia, made some very athletic plays. A lot of people, Scott, the buzz is he could be another Eddie Jackson-type player. You remember Eddie didn't really kind of bud until his junior year when he was moved to safety, as you recall. So I think Deontay Thompson, keep an eye on him. You mentioned Xavier McKinney, Daniel Wright. Those were two true freshmen that played a lot last year. Played some, not a lot, but played some. And that they've got a lot of talent, though. So I would keep an eye on both of those young guys at the safety spots.
All right, now let's talk about some guys that could get playing time. It begins with Patrick Surtain, Jr., in my opinion. He's got that Minkah Fitzpatrick feel where he could be literally anywhere that they need him this year and years to come. Let's talk about the guys coming in.
Yeah, Patrick Surtain, what a big pickup for people who may not follow recruiting extremely closely. Patrick Surtain out of Plantation, Florida, American Heritage High School. His dad was a former NFL player, great player in college at Southern Miss as a cornerback, was a top draft pick there for the Dolphins and really successful player. So he knows what it is to play the position. And I say that because, you know, Patrick Surtain grew up in that. You know, have a dad that coaches your position that played in the NFL. What an advantage that is. And, you know, we see how that sometimes when you have that advantage, it creates a really strong competitor. And I think when you look at Patrick Surtain, he's a perfect fit for Nick Saban, I think. I think, you know, that all of the experience that he's had with his dad certainly will be very helpful when he gets here this summer. And I agree with you, Scott. He has that same kind of feel. You're not comparing him to Minkah Fitzpatrick, but you're saying he brings that same kind of feel to him, that he could probably play just about any spot in the secondary. Cornerback, could play at the star position.
Right.
Could play, you know, safety if he needed to be. But, yeah, I think he's going to be a really valuable addition. I tell you what now, Joshua Job, he's kind of got lost in the shuffle. This is another guy that was a highly recruited player that – Alabama got to flip from Miami, who is, as I said, very, very highly recruited, very highly rated. I think when you look at the cornerbacks in last year's class, Surtain, Joshua Job, and Tyson Campbell, who ended up in Georgia, those were probably the three top corners in the nation. And guess what? Alabama got two of them. And Job is a guy that I think is, if he can catch on quickly, he's going to be a real threat for playing time at the corner spot. And a guy that I think is vastly underrated, and I've said this many times, Eddie Smith, who will be coming in from Slidell, Louisiana. What a competitor he is. A guy that LSU flat out overlooked. But Jeremy Pruitt really wanted him badly at Tennessee. Texas A&M wanted him badly. Several other schools. Alabama got in on him. He was a guy that did not shy away from competition. He made it clear to the Alabama coaching staff, look, if you want me, I'm ready to come in and compete. That's just his attitude. He's long. He's 6'1". He's athletic. I think he may be one of the most underrated players in the country from last year's class. He'll be here in fall competing as well. And Jalen Armour-Davis is another guy signed in this class. And again, when you start mentioning all these names, Scott, somehow some guys get just kind of overlooked in some ways. And I think Jalen Armour-Davis is one of those guys. You look at him in high school and you watch his tape. And you talk about the versatility of Minkah Fitzpatrick when he was in high school. Minkah was an outstanding running back. He was an outstanding receiver. He's a tremendous defensive back, could do it all. You watch Jalen Armour-Davis, same way. I mean, he was tremendous as a defensive player, but he was also a big-time playmaker as a receiver. So you kind of see that athleticism and ability that he has. Now, he needs to get a little bit bigger. I think he played last year at about 6'1", 177 or so. And he needs to get a little bit bigger, a little bit stronger, and all of those types of things. But he has all the skills. He can play corner. He can play star. He can play safety. So, again, the athleticism and the versatility of Jalen Armour-Davis, I really like that.
And, look, I think you and I agree, Minkah Fitzpatrick's probably the greatest defensive back in Alabama history, all due respect to Jeremiah Castile and others that have been there. I think there's no doubt Minkah Fitzpatrick's the greatest. It sounds like they're in good hands. Now we go to who I think was the greatest punter in Alabama history, all due respect to Greg Gantt and some of the guys, Chris Moore from the past. But I think J.K. Scott was a difference maker, a field flipper. You know, he was worth 5 to 10 yards virtually every time Alabama had to punt. What a weapon. So where does Alabama go now with this?
J.K. Scott, it just seems like his career flew by, Scott.
Yeah, really
it really does. I mean, what a great, great punter he was, and what talent he brought as a place kicker as well, even though he didn't get many opportunities. I mean, so – but as you move forward and you start thinking about, okay, how can we replace J.K. Scott? I like Da'Ron Payne, I don't think you can replace him because, as you said, Scott, I mean, he's a once in a almost program type player, you know, at that position. But, you know, obviously there are some guys out there that can be good. And I think one guy to keep an eye on is Skylar DeLong. He signed in this year's class. Some people think he might have been the best high school punter in the country out of South Carolina. Was originally committed to Tennessee, but flipped to Alabama during the process of recruiting. And, you know, he's a guy that, fortunately, he is here this spring. We'll go through spring practice, and we'll have a better idea about, you know, him as we move forward in spring practice. So one of the positive things about it all, though, is that you have Jeff Banks here now, who is a legitimate, real special teams coach. He's a kicker's coach. He's a special teams coach overall. That is his forte. That's what he did as a player. So he has a great understanding of that and has done a tremendous job of developing players in those areas, not only kickers, but return guys. And so I really think that Jeff Banks being here certainly will be beneficial this spring to Skylar DeLong. And what a name for a punter, Skylar DeLong. Think about it.
So that's a look at our defense, brought to you again by Hong Kong Tailors. They're in Homewood near Birmingham, but they're literally – Ramesh Kirpalani, I visited him last week. He's very excited about the podcast and upcoming things coming on. And he will make your clothing. He'll talk to you. He wants to become a member of your family, so to speak, obviously, and really get to know his customers and clients. He has outfitted a lot of guys in the past. He's made clothes for former athletic director Bill Battle, some other people. Greg McElroy goes to him for his tailoring needs. John Parker Wilson, who's in the financial planning business here in Birmingham. A lot of Alabama connections there with Ramesh Kirpalani. And again, he'll come to you. He'll come to Tuscaloosa. He'll come to Birmingham, Huntsville, Mobile, wherever, and talk to you about your style and let him fit you. And it's not all about the most expensive suit you can get tailored. He does sport coats, casual pants, slacks with the shirts these days, because everybody does business casual. All of that is included in the fashion at KirpalaniTailors.com. Hong Kong Tailors is the name on the front of the sign, and Homewood Kirpalani Tailors on the website. Be sure you reach out to him, contact him, tell him you heard it here, and just see what he has to say. Great alterations, incredible tailoring. He does all of my clothing, and I couldn't be happier with not only the friendship, but the tailor just expertise that Ramesh Kirpalani and his staff does. So check out KirpalaniTailors.com. All right, Rodney, just a summation from you. We've done the offense. We've done the defense. Give me two or three key factors in order of what you're looking for in the spring here, what your eyes are going to focus on.
Well, I think, first of all, it's a secondary. I think that obviously you lose six players back there. And it's a major overhaul job that they've got to do. You know, we mentioned all the players that are candidates for those spots. So I think that's one place that you really have to shore up. I think the development of the defensive line is another key. That's why I'm so excited to watch and interested to watch Craig Kuligowski on that defensive line, because he's been so successful at developing those guys. So I think that's a key. Inside linebacker, going to be interested to see who all's working there. Maybe if one or two of the outside guys that we mentioned might get some looks there, some reps there this spring. On the offensive side, I would say that the offensive line, again, I think there's probably going to be some shuffling, some experimenting going on this spring to try to find the five best guys. We talked about Alex Leatherwood and Jedrick Wills, the two guys, rising sophomores who are so talented. I think those two guys are guys to watch on the offensive line, and who will fill in for Bradley Bozeman. Will Jonah Williams move over in that spot? Maybe will one other guy. We've mentioned several names in our last podcast or possibilities there. I think a couple of guys that I really want to mention, Scott, on the offensive side, they're young players to keep an eye on. Tight end Kedrick James, even though that position, you've got help.
You love that guy. You love that guy.
Yes. Yes. Listen, let me tell you. You've got Irv Smith. You've got Miller Forstall coming back. This Kedrick James out of Waco, Texas, I mean, he was a three-star player. I think they totally missed on this guy. Alabama did a great job of evaluating him. He's 6'5". He's 260 plus. Very, very athletic. I think it's just a matter of time before he's going to become an outstanding player at the tight end spot. And also, another Texan out of Lewisville, Texas, Terrell Shavers, wide receiver, came in with all that group last year. You know, Judy, Smith, Ruggs, all of those guys performed big time in the championship game, obviously. But this Terrell Shavers was redshirted. Scott, he's a totally different look as a receiver. 6'6", 215 pounds that could run. It's a matter of him developing. I'm going to be interested to watch him because you can use him in so many different ways. Think about him and Kedrick James in red zone throwing the ball to those guys with that height. Just amazing. So those are two guys that I would really keep an eye on. And a lot of people ask about the return game. We didn't really address that. But yeah, as we look forward to next year, obviously Trevon Diggs handled the punt returns late this past year and early in the year before he had trouble, you know, kind of fielding the ball. But he wasn't the only one, as we recall, that had those issues. But I would say next year, even though he's not here this spring, let's mention Jalen Waddle, the incoming freshman from the Houston area in Bel Air, Texas. I think this guy has a chance to be a difference maker as a punt return guy and also as a slot receiver. I would keep an eye on him. And even Slade Bolden, who is here this spring as a slot receiver and possibly as a punt return guy, a guy that accounted for 110 career touchdowns at West Monroe, Louisiana. So keep an eye on all of those guys. I think it's going to be an interesting spring. Alabama has a ton of young talent, so it should be a lot of fun to watch.
Great stuff. Great information as always. It never ends, by the way, at TiderInsider.com. It's only $48 a year. Think about that. Less than half $100, less than 50 gets you all the best message forums out there that's informative, entertaining. It'll make you crazy. It'll make you laugh, but you will get information on the message forums. We do all the videos, the podcasting, great articles, the stories. Rodney, of course, he has a lot of expertise, but really knows how to focus down recruiting. And let me just say this while we're talking. I don't do long commercials for Rodney, but there's a lot of people out there that the recruiting is a shotgun blast. It's okay. Everybody's looking at them. Because let's be honest, the Alabamas, Auburns, Georgias of the world are sending out stuff to everybody. So in your mind, you think, wow, Alabama's interested in 475 guys. Rodney really has the inside intel on focusing down to the ones you got to really get in on. So they got all that at TiderInsider.com. $48 a year. If you're not a member, it is a no-brainer to do that. Rod, I will see you in the coming days as we get ready for spring. We want an update on the power washer and the car and all the other things that you started the show with today that you were very concerned with. I hope you get that handled.
Well, I've got a lot of versatility, Scott, so I have no question that I'll eventually figure it all out.
So
I'll call you.
You're the Minkah Fitzpatrick of home care. I like that. You're a five star.
Yeah.
Yeah, right. Yeah,
that's why I use paper play.
All right, for Rodney Orr, Scott Griffin, say so long. We'll have an update a few days into spring practice, tell you what we see. Keep it right here, podbean.com, Tide and Tiger, also the YouTube channel, and again, TiderInsider.com for Rodney or Scott Griffin saying, have a great rest of the week.